Good morning, everybody. So yesterday we were talking about different aspects of fresh concrete behavior. We saw how the rheological design of concrete can be done to control its flowability for specific applications, primarily dealing with special concretes like self-compacting concrete. Today we will continue the discussion on pumping of concrete. Now, pumping, as you know, has become increasingly crucial because of number of reasons. We want to place concrete in inaccessible areas, obviously, which cannot be easily placed by people carrying concrete in different ways of conveyance. Direct conveyance of concrete can be done from the truck to formwork to avoid double handling. You know that the more number of hands that are in between the concrete that is delivered by the truck and what actually goes into the structure, the more number of hands implies there is possibility of more segregation, right? The more number of times that you handle concrete, you increase the possibility of segregation. Then, of course, transporting over vertical distances, all of you know about the fact that today the pumps are strong enough to really pump over very large vertical distances. So one of the examples is your Burj Khalifa, where the world record for pumping was created, 600 meters vertical pumping was done, okay. And please remember that was not just done based on a trial laboratory mix. They actually did a field trial with about 2+ kilometers length of pipes which were laid on ground, and they tried the same mix through the 2 kilometers of pipe to ensure that they were able to understand the extent of pumping pressure that they would need and whether the concrete which is coming at the other end would have robust properties or not. So that was a properly simulated experiment which was done on the site after the lab design was done with the concrete, okay. And of course, we can also lower the labor costs. Of course, this may or may not be required depending on the situation, but in certain conditions, even when you have access to a lot of labor, it may be more preferable to go for pumping from the point of view of saving time and also accessing areas which are not easy to access by humans, okay. So requirements for pumping are on the rise. We want to pump more and more because construction projects today are handled on very tight schedules, and just relying on labor to fulfill the concreting operations may not be always a good task. So there are different types of concrete pumps that are used in construction. There are two principal types of pumps. One is a direct acting piston type pump, which essentially applies pressure with a piston. The other is a squeeze pump, which uses vacuum to pull the concrete. So there are two types of pumps. Of course, a piston pump has a lot more ability to pump over longer distances. In general, you can cover a horizontal distance of 1000 meter, nearly a kilometer, and a vertical distance of 120 meter with the conventional pipes, which are about 8 inch. But there are specialty applications where, of course, you know that up to 600 meters of vertical pumping is also done using the direct acting piston type pumps. The squeeze pumps are a little bit less effective, okay, but then of course you are spending less energy in doing the vacuum process. So these are peristaltic pumps, and these pumps can pump over 90 to 100 meter distance horizontally and about 30 meters vertically. And assuming 3 inch pipes, you can pump about 20 meter cube of concrete per hour. So again, the capacity of the pump will obviously depend on the amount of pressure that you can pump the concrete with, and also the pipeline which is carrying the concrete, right. So your concreting operations, depending upon what the conditions demand, you would be choosing one or the other type of pump, okay. Now, of course, this is just a diagrammatic representation from your textbook, and here you show the direct acting pump has this piston that is trying to push the concrete. So this is the hopper into which the concrete is poured from the truck, okay, and there is a valve which opens to ensure that the concrete continuously gets filled up into this pumped section. So as the concrete is pumped, this valve rotates in this direction so that the concrete is able to continuously get pumped outside. So what happens is the pipe is always full of concrete, so that the piston, even when it's taking its backward stroke, right, so the piston has to move forward and backward with each stroke, right. When it moves forward, obviously it pushes the concrete through. When it moves backward, it pulls in more concrete into the pipe. So the hopper has to be continuously fed with concrete to ensure that the pipe keeps getting filled up with concrete. So you don't want any breaks in the pump process, because that would create air gaps, and obviously when there's an air gap in the pumping process, you have a problem, right. You can't pump air, so that creates a choking in your pipe. So as long as the pipe is continuously filled up with concrete, your pumping can happen without any interruptions. the case of a squeeze pump, this is a collating hopper and this is a vacuum pumping chamber. So, it is simply pulling the concrete and conveying it directly to the pipeline. Okay. So, there is just a vacuum which is pulling the concrete and then conveying it to the pipeline. So, this is some examples of pump manufacturers. Reed, common pump manufacturer in India is obviously Schwing, you must have seen that name somewhere. Yeah, Schwing, Schwing-Stetter, that is the joint venture company that makes a lot of concreting equipment, including the RMC plant equipment, the RMC trucks for instance, many of them are made with Schwing-Stetter. So, what are the criteria that we have to use for selecting the right pipes for pumping? First of all, what we need to understand is when we lay the pipeline which is going to convey the pumped concrete, we need to avoid the bends as much as possible, because every time there is a bend, there is a possibility of the concrete choking. So, each 10 degree bend is equivalent to an extra length of pipe of 1 meter. What does an extra length mean? More friction because of the extra length of the pipe. So, you are losing your workability with additional length of pumping. So, when you have a 10 degree bend, that is equivalent to 1 meter length of pipe. So, every time that you have a bend, you need to ensure that you are overcoming that extra friction that is getting created because of that. Okay. The pipe diameter typically is chosen to be at least 3 times the maximum aggregate size. Otherwise, what will happen is the larger aggregates can start getting blocked, especially when there is a bend in the pipeline. Okay. So, pipe diameter has to be chosen based on the type of concrete that is being used at the site. How is the aggregate size in concrete decided? By the spacing between the reinforcement or the clear cover, whichever is lesser, right? Based on that, you reduce 5 millimeters from that and decide on the maximum size of aggregate in the concrete. The other aspect to consider there is of course the type of concrete that you are pumping. If you are pumping highly flowable concretes, the size of the aggregate should be even controlled to be smaller. Otherwise, a lot of aggregate flowing together in a rapid succession may start blocking the at the obstacles. The economy of pumping obviously depends on number of interruptions. So, as I said, you do not want interruptions during pumping. The there has to be a continuous supply of concrete through the pump, because every time you interrupt and you start a new batch of concrete, you need to ensure that you send in some mortar first to prime the walls of the pump. Why do we do that? To reduce the friction between the pipe and the concrete. So, before we pump a new batch of concrete, we need to send in a priming mortar, and that can take a considerable amount of time to prime the surface of the pipes using this mortar. So, as far as possible, minimize the interruptions while pumping. Aluminium pipes have to be avoided. You know very well that aluminium in the alkaline environment of concrete can react with the lime and produce hydrogen gas. This hydrogen gas liberated can obviously create bubbles inside your concrete, and you are trying to then push air, which may not be a very wise thing to do. And that is why you know very well that for aerated concrete, for concrete that is lightweight, aluminium powder is used to generate the air bubbles in the concrete. Okay, what about the concrete itself? We want a fairly high workability for the concrete, but at the same time, too flowable a mix would be tending towards segregation if you are trying to pressurize it. So, you need to control the slump of the concrete to be about 100 to 150. Otherwise, when you are working with self-compacting concrete, for instance, you can pump it. It has been pumped. Of course, the world record is with SCC, but you need to be extra careful in designing your right pumping system, deciding the pump pressures and all based on that, because very high pressures can tend to segregate highly flowable concrete. So, your concrete mixture can get segregated primarily because fines are not enough. Okay. If your water content is low, again your friction is high. If the water content is high, then your possibility to segregate is more. So, again designing the concrete has to be done very carefully. Now, high cement content is generally beneficial for pumping, obviously, because you are forming a richer mix. When you have a richer mix, it captures the water quite well and the paste is more cohesive, which causes an ease of pumping. Now, what I have not talked about is there are also admixtures which are available, which are called pumping aids. Okay, these are glycol based admixtures. So, the pumping aid simply helps to reduce the pressure required to pump the concrete. Okay, or even the VMAs would actually be good pumping aids. Why? Because they make the mix more cohesive, and once you pressurize the mix, it will move as one. So, if you have a self-compacting concrete, for instance, to make it get pumped uniformly, it may be better to have a viscosity modifying agent also in the mix. So, your water does not get segregated from the concrete, it stays within the concrete if you have a VMA and the whole mass moves as one. Okay. So, essentially, because water is the component that you are trying to pump, the solid components are going to reduce the efficiency of pumping. So, water is carrying the other components along with it. Okay. So, pumped concrete has to be designed carefully. Of course, in most cases we deal with regular mix design without considerations for pumping. So, very often when we take the lab based mix design to the site, we need to do a field testing operation to see whether all the criteria are getting satisfied or not. There are several other factors that affect pumping, including shape of aggregate, presence of admixtures like pumping aids, or sometimes air entrainment. Now, when you are trying to pump air entrained concrete, what do you expect? Air voids will do what? Air voids will tend to slow down the efficiency of pumping. So, again, air entrained concrete, you need to be careful with pumping, especially lightweight concrete, which is based on a lot of air which is inside the system, foamed concrete and cellular concrete. It may be very difficult to pump those type of concrete because there is a lot of air in the system. So, pushing that type of concrete through may not be an easy task. Okay. So, flowing concrete, you need to ensure that your mixture is highly cohesive. That is why utilization of a VMA is always better as far as pumping is concerned. And the VMAs can, in some instances, even with normal concrete, they can act as pumping aids. Of course, these days a lot of pumping is done in conjunction with the use of boom places, because these are again extending the reach of your concrete. So, there is actually some case study in China where because of the use of boom places, they were able to place the entire raft for a huge stadium, for an indoor stadium. They were able to place an entire raft in probably a matter of a couple of days or something like that. So, several tens of thousands of cubic meters of concrete in just a couple of days could have happened only because of the use of boom places. Okay, just I wanted to put that, of course, all of you have seen boom places in action, right? And they give you access to areas which are otherwise difficult to reach within the site. Okay.